In this video, I want to share what were my highlights of WWDC 2023 as an iOS developer. I'm not going to talk about what has been announced during the keynote because I'm sure you've already heard all about it, and instead I'm going to focus on what I call the second keynote, so the platform State of the Union, which is the second event that happens a few hours after the keynote, and it is much more focused on all the developer related announcements. And among these announcements, one that really gets me excited is the release of Swift macros. From what I understand, Swift macros are basically a code generation tool, kind of like Sorcery, but unlike Sorcery, this time it's directly built into the language. And Apple shared a few examples of how you can use these new macros. For instance, you can annotate an enum with the macro at case detection, and Swift will automatically generate for you properties that will allow you to test whether or not a current value of the enum corresponds to a given case. Of course, you can already write this code by hand today, but by using Swift macros, this code that is highlighted on the slide will be automatically generated for you by the compiler. But annotations are not the only way to use Swift macros. You can also use them with a syntax that is more similar to a function call. So here we are calling the macro URL with the syntax hashtag URL, and we pass it a string, and the macro will take care of turning that string into a proper URL. And what's really great is that the macro will also perform compile time checks in order to verify that the string is indeed a valid URL. This ability to easily implement compile time checks over the data that our code handles is something that was kind of lacking in Swift. And so I'm very excited to see that we finally have the tools to implement it. But it doesn't stop here for what can be achieved with macros, because macros can also be used to annotate functions. Here you can see that a function that uses a completion handler is annotated with a macro called addAsync. And what this macro will do is that it will automatically generate the code of an async overload of that same function. This is honestly pretty powerful and just basically impressive, and I'm really curious to see what the iOS community will be able to do with this, because this new syntax, I think it opens up the way to a lot of cool new frameworks and libraries. And there's definitely much more left to explore with macros, because Apple shared the name of a few built-in macros, and we can see some very interesting things here, like for instance addCompletionHandler, which I guess does the reverse of addAsync, or at memberwise init, which I guess automatically generates a memberwise initializer so that we no longer need to type it by hand. And this is definitely the kind of quality of life that should be super useful whenever we need to implement a class, for example. Now let's move on to the announcements regarding Swift UI. So first announcement was that the default timing function for animations will now be using a spring animation. This kind of makes sense because I've got the feeling that Apple's own apps have been using Spring animations as a default for quite some time. And it's true that Spring animations have this nice behavior of making your app feel very snappy and very alive. And so it's pretty cool to see that this is now becoming the default for animations in SwiftUI apps. Still on the topic of animations, SwiftUI had a lot of possibilities to implement custom animations by adding something called a phase animator, which allows you to implement simple phases into an animation. And you can also get even more control by doing keyframes animation, which is basically a way to create key references during your animation where you specify the value for a given property, and then you let SwiftUI interpolate among these values. Now let's move on to how we write code in SwiftUI, because there's definitely a lot of changes there. So this is how we would up until now write a view model in SwiftUI, by implementing the protocol observable object and then annotating each property that should produce a change in the UI with @published. But this is changing in the new version of SwiftUI, because thanks to the support of Swift macros, now we can simply annotate our view model with @observable. And from what I understand, this will have the consequence of automatically making the class conform to observable object, and also automatically annotating every property with add published. So when I was telling you that Swift macros are basically a form of code source generation, here you have a typical example of this at play. But Swift UI is not the only Swift framework that hugely benefits from the additions of macros to the language, because there was also the announcement for a highly anticipated new framework called Swift Data, which is kind of a successor to Core Data, even though I think it is actually more of a Swift wrapper layer around Core Data. But what's really exciting is the syntax of this framework, because this is how a model, a persisted model, looks like when you use Swift Data. And you can see it's basically a class that you annotate with at model, and everything else is generated for you thanks to the macro model that you are using. And of course, Swift Data supports all the features you would expect from a persistent framework, like for instance, the ability to be able to say that a property must have unique values across all instances. And finally, to conclude on the topic of Swift Data, here's a slide Apple shared which shows the Swift Data stack at play. And you can see that it's not that different to how you would use Core Data in a Swift UI app. So hopefully, if you already have a Core Data app written in Swift UI, migrating from Core Data to Swift Data shouldn't be that hard. Now let's move on to another topic where Apple also made some pretty exciting announcements. That topic is StoreKit, and Apple announced a new Swift UI view that basically lets you create a paywall with a single line of code. So from what I understand, you pass it the ID of the StoreKit items you want your user to be able to buy, and this entire view is automatically generated for you by Swift UI. And what's pretty impressive here is that not only it generates an iOS view, but it also generates the view for all Apple platforms. So here you can see the same paywall being presented on a watch, but it doesn't stop here, because that paywall is also localized. So here you can see an example of the paywall appearing in a right to left languages. And finally, you can even customize this paywall with a bit of code. So this should be quite an exciting announcement for app developers that are still in the process of releasing their first subscription plan, because implementing an App Store compliant paywall is a task that requires a lot of time, resources, and energy. By using this Apple built-in one-line paywall, they will be able to save on these precious resources and put them to other use. Now let's move on to the new announcements regarding Xcode itself. So first, Xcode is supposed to have gained some smarter autocomplete. As you can see, when you call a view modifier on a Swift UI view, Xcode should autocomplete using the context available, and so should not suggest the same modifier whether you are calling it on a text or on an image. Then previews have also gotten a lot better. You can see by the use of the hashtag symbol that Swift macros are once again at play here. And now when you want to implement a preview, you just need to do hashtag preview, and you no longer need to declare the struct that conforms to preview providers. This will be automatically generated for you. But it doesn't stop here, because the really big announcement is that now previews no longer only work with Swift UI, but they also work with UIKit and AppKit. And while this was already possible by making your view conform to the protocol UI view representable, for instance, now this layer of compatibility is no longer needed. You can just create a preview, put a UI button inside of it, and that UI button will be displayed inside the preview in Xcode, even though it is a UIKit object and not a Swift UI view. And finally, last announcement I wanted to share in this video, testing has become better in Xcode. First, you can see this new testing dashboard, which hopefully should make it easier to understand which tests fail and why. And finally, UI tests have also gotten much better with a new timeline view that allows you to replay a test and hopefully pinpoint the exact moment and reason for which it has failed. That's all for this video. These were my highlights of WWDC 2023 that I wanted to share with you. If there is any new topic that gets you particularly excited and you would like me to make a video about it, please let me know in the comments. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.